And welcome to our talk on why the Paris Agreement negotiations succeeded while those in Copenhagen failed. Our speaker today is Richard Kinley. But before I introduce him, let me introduce myself. My name is Milan Kandekar. I'm joint head of the Hagen School of Public Policy and also the director for the Institute for Resources, Environment and Sustainability. But before we begin, and I'm going to read this out because usually I make an error here, I'd like to acknowledge that we are meeting on the traditional, ancestral, and unceded lands of the Musqueam peoples who've called this area home for many thousands of years and continue to do so today. To those of you unfamiliar with this, UBC is on occupied land. To share a bit of background now about our special guest, Richard Kinley. He served as the Deputy Executive Secretary of the UN Climate Change Secretariat from 2006 to 2017. He supported the Executive Secretary in managing and developing a large international organization of over 590 staff. He saw secretarial operational and strategic support to the international climate negotiations, including the process of negotiating the Paris Accord. He also oversaw the organization of climate change conferences, which are the largest annual events in the UN calendar, including the landmark Paris Climate Change Conference in 2015. And if you've been to one of these climate conferences, they are absolutely epic events, so it's quite a challenge, I'm sure. Welcome, Richard.
Thank you very much, Professor Kandekar. I'm really happy to be here at the UBC today. And I'm a bit, we've talked about whether we needed a microphone. If a well-projecting professor needs a microphone, I can't imagine what a soft-spoken diplomat needs. So, let's see. So, first, big thanks to the New Institute for organizing this and for inviting me to speak, and especially to Lindsay for organizing everything. I also wanted to say a special thanks to my very, very long-time friend Vivian Forsman, who was the instigator of this and had the idea that this was something I should do to distract me from the pleasures of my vacation. So, but this is a pleasure to us. And then thanks to all of you for coming. I hope we can have a good conversation. I don't want to just be the talking head here. But before we start, I wanted to get to know you a bit better, so ask you a couple of questions, which you can answer just by a show of hands. So first, how many of you, or who among you, have been to a climate change negotiation? So handful. Anybody in Paris? Yes, okay. Then, about your disciplines or background, who's a climate policy person? Yeah. International relations? Public policy? Okay. And I've missed many, many more, but that gives me a sense. And how about anybody who's been an activist for social change, either being in an NGO or demonstrating? So, good. And I hear there's a big demonstration this afternoon, so you may get more experience at that. So, what I wanted to do today was make a presentation, and I apologize, it's not PowerPoint. I find PowerPoint can be risky, in particular after lunch. So, I will speak a bit about some context, because I think the background can be helpful. And then, and that would be about climate architecture, the climate regime, and the climate secretariat. And then the meat or the lentils of the presentation, looking at the actors and the issues that played out in Copenhagen and then in Paris. And finally, wrapping up with some conclusions and a postscript. We have, I hope, we'll have lots of time at the end for questions and a bit of a discussion, but if you find I'm blathering on and talking in jargon and acronyms that are unintelligible, just stick your hand up and we can have some clarification as we go along. I have to make a disclaimer. So I no longer work for the United Nations. So these are my personal views and should not be ascribed to the UN or to the UN Climate Change Secretariat. So I'll try to be provocative but not suicidal. And you know, it's my attribution, so if you want to quote, that's fine. So the context for what I wanted to talk about today, and I think it's useful to understand what happened in Paris to have a bit of a sense of what this climate process is about, in particular if you haven't been to one of these epic events that Professor Kandekar was referring to. Before Paris, there were three significant moments in international climate policy. The first was the Climate Convention, the second was the Kyoto Protocol, and the third was Copenhagen. So, the Framework Convention on Climate Change was agreed in 1992, was adopted, then opened for signature at the big Rio conference, and it sets up general obligations and principles that are quite important even to this day, and I tend to believe that if we try to negotiate the principles of the Climate Change Convention today, it would not be possible, because the climate has been so politicized in the intervening period. The convention also set up institutions, the main governing bodies, and the secretariat. The obligations that it includes are quite general. That countries should take action, that for industrialized countries, that they should limit their emissions and support developing countries. It was very much focused on mitigation over adaptation to the impacts of climate change. And very important, it set up in its structure the concept of industrialized countries and developing countries as a main architectural device for international climate policy. And you remember in 1992, China was a developing country. I still remember delegates pounding the table in climate negotiations saying China will always be a developing country. And now it's the major global emitter of greenhouse gases. So we've cut is one positive and negative change that we've seen over the course of the last 25 or so years. So moment number two, even as the convention was being adopted, it was pretty much accepted that it was inadequate to the challenge that we faced because it didn't have much in terms of substantive commitments. So as soon as the convention came into force, there was agreement to start the negotiation of a new round, a new agreement. And interestingly, you may find that one of the main instigators of that push to start the negotiations was Angela Merkel, who's today the Chancellor of Germany. So she was one of the climate architects, has been actually active in climate negotiations for a long time. So that launched negotiations was culminated in the Kyoto Protocol in 1997, which was designed to build on the convention and have more specific commitments. So the bargain for the Kyoto negotiation was that, again, this architecture I mentioned before of developed and developing countries, the obligations would only be for developed, industrialized countries, and that they would be quantified. So the Kyoto Protocol includes percentage emission reductions that each country, each industrialized country has to achieve. It also included lots of requirements for reporting, telling what you do, and it established the international carbon market, which was a key demand of the United States at that time. So mentioning the United States is a good entree to saying why the Kyoto Protocol, I guess, was basically doomed from the start. Although Al Gore came to Kyoto and was instrumental in making the deal, it was clear that given the situation in the US Congress, there's no way that the Kyoto Protocol would be ratified by the United States. And then George Bush was elected quite soon afterwards, and they withdrew from the Kyoto Protocol. The reason for that was ostensibly this question of who has obligations, developed or developing countries, but I think it was much deeper, this fundamental issue you have in the United States about appreciation of climate change as an issue. But I would say, looking back now, what, 20 years, the Kyoto Protocol actually delivered what it promised. Most of the industrialized countries met the targets that they accepted. Canada is one exception to that, and then it ended up withdrawing from the protocol. But as a whole, the industrialized countries met the target in the Kyoto Protocol of reducing their emissions by 5%. For me, though, the most important legacy of the Kyoto Protocol was that it kept the climate issue on the agenda. Through some very dark times, through the Bush period, the Kyoto Protocol was climate change for a long time, whether in international discussions or in many national discussions. It was the promoter of what action could be made on climate change. Then leap ahead over 10 years to the Copenhagen conference, which I'll get into in more detail a bit later. There was significant build-up to the conference, huge expectations. The real story was that it was a complete and total mess. And I say that with some humility, having been deeply involved, and some might even say responsible for some of that mess. But the negotiations were extraordinarily complicated. I'll say a bit more about that in a minute, but it was things like, do we extend the Kyoto Protocol or not? Do we have a new treaty with commitments with a different kind of architecture? What to do about funding for developing countries? And we entered the conference in Copenhagen with a completely incomprehensible negotiating text of hundreds of pages with brackets and options that it would have been impossible to deal with. In the end, what came out of Copenhagen was a non-treaty, a declaration type of thing called the Copenhagen Accord. It had no legal standing, and we spent 12 hours in a plenary meeting broadcast live around the world fighting about whether this should be taken note of or ignored. It was heavy recriminations. It was really a very painful moment, with a legacy that most people who participated in that were determined that this should never ever happen again. Then a word about the international climate negotiations. Professor Candler mentioned that they're epic. I would use three words, or three come at it from three angles. One is scale, one is complexity, and one is contentiousness. So scale, epic, is I guess the word. Starting from quite humble beginning in the 90s, a few hundred people would come to these meetings. Now they're regularly attended by 15 to 20,000 people. In Paris, we have 35,000 people present in the course of the 2 weeks. And this is governments who constitute perhaps a quarter to a third of the participants, and then a huge civil society component with all actors from society. And actually, I like to call these events a climate change jamboree. Everybody wants to be there. It sort of becomes a self-defining moment. I saw you in wherever, Nairobi, or this, that, and the other place. So it really is the happening place. And I think, as the professor indicated, they are now the biggest events in the UN calendar that happen every year. I think it's also then, my second point, complexity. The climate change issue is not easy. It touches every economic sector, whether you're talking about emission reductions or adaptation to the impacts of climate change. You're hitting every button in every economy, and everybody has interests that are competing. There's no easy fix, plus all overlaid by huge issues of fairness, burden sharing, of responsibility. So all of this makes for a very complex political situation, compounded by the fact that in the negotiations themselves, everybody wants their issue on the agenda, so we have huge unmanageable agendas that need to be somehow organized in a way that you can have a civilized and a meaningful conversation. Then contentiousness, everything in the climate negotiations is political. I sort of joke that even the grocery list has to be negotiated. But a lot of this contentiousness is also very bitter, and it has become, I think, increasingly bitter over some years as developing countries in particular feel that developed countries have not lived up to their commitments, either in terms of emissions or in terms of financial support, which is overlain by the whole question of historical responsibility. Who is responsible for the situation that we face today? All of these three factors linked together, scale, complexity, and contentiousness, mean that it is extremely difficult to get agreement on anything. And we saw this in spades in Copenhagen, but it does happen. And I would say Paris was, I would like to make the case in what I say later, that Paris was not a miracle. It was not some divine intervention. It happened for particular reasons. And these reasons may be helpful for understanding other negotiations or for other public policy work. My last piece of context would be about the climate change secretary, where I have the pleasure, honor, privilege to work for over 20 years, and it's basically the civil service of the climate change negotiations. It started off with almost nobody in its staff, and it grew to over 500, 550 in the heady days of the global carbon market, but now it's about 425 people, which I still think is pretty small when you can contrast that to the staff of any middle-sized city in the world. That's running. What is it doing? It's organizing these big negotiations and all of the infrastructure around them, the committees and things that are the implementation devices of the process. It runs reporting, reviewing of national action, because there is quite a lot of data accumulated, and then reviewing that data, and it also continues to support the carbon market. Increasingly, it's getting into promotion of action by non-governmental actors, business, provinces, and states, etc. Maybe before I then move on to the next part of my presentation, I will just pause here and see if anybody has any questions on that that first introduction. All right, I'm glad I was so amazingly clear. All right, so save the questions and we'll come back. Comparison of what happened in Copenhagen and Paris. Copenhagen took place in 2009, Paris in 2015. So 6 years in between, a lot of things changed, and that's what I would like to talk about, in particular by looking at a number of factors that I hope might be useful for you in your research and in understanding either this issue or other issues. Now, I would divide these into categories of actors, political factors, and socioeconomic changes. Unfortunately, there is quite a bit of entanglement between these, so it's hard to have completely discrete baskets, but I'll do my best. So let's start first with the actors, and of course governments are the most important in this equation. It's an intergovernmental negotiation where there were significant differences between the situation in Copenhagen and in Paris. I would characterize the situation pre-Copenhagen as governments had been working sort of to get an agreement, but they arrived confused and even ambivalent. It was more hoping than working for a miracle. In Paris, the situation was completely different. Governments wanted an agreement, and they had been working for 2 years to get that agreement, constantly in bilateral conversations, in the negotiations themselves, at the highest level, when heads of state and government met one another, they talked about climate change, and they talked about how they could solve the problems and how they could move forward. So there was a completely different intergovernmental context at the time of Paris. And I would say, in particular, the leading countries wanted an outcome in Paris. Supplemented by the fact that vulnerable countries, in particular islands, were extremely active in their advocacy and in pushing for an ambitious outcome. So, if we speak about now the two big actors, US and China, in Copenhagen, President Obama came to Copenhagen. He actually participated in the late night negotiations that happened at the end that were so chaotic. But I would say before that he had not been so engaged. The administration was really not all that ready. By the time of Paris, we had a situation where the US administration had been putting in place regulations to deal with emission sources. They had been dealing with cars, with the power sector. And I think we have to acknowledge that fracking had a big impact because of the way it affected the price of oil and the price of coal, the price of gas, I guess, more accurately. But this meant that US emissions were actually going down. And there's nothing like having declining emissions to allow you to be ambitious. So the US was very much in the forefront of wanting an agreement in Copenhagen. Interestingly, the situation in China, I would say, going into Copenhagen, they were very ambivalent. They were still undecided, or no, they were still very much in the developing country camp, and had a feeling of solidarity with developing countries, so it was quite a contentious situation, although the Prime Minister of China participated in these negotiations with Obama and the Prime Minister of India, etc. By the time of Paris, 6 years later, we've seen this huge change. China is the number one emitter, it is a huge industrial power, and it has huge, huge environmental problems at home, which are a very serious political problem for the government. And they are then acting also to deal with their emissions, making undertakings to reduce the use of coal, phase out even, and also very putting a lot of emphasis on technology innovation, renewables, clean energy, etc. So So we had a situation where China also opportunistically wanted an outcome because it was in their interest to have an ambitious outcome in Paris. So what we saw was the two leaders of the world, the G2, I mean, who would talk about the G2 today? But then we were talking about the G2, who had an understanding amongst themselves. Even at the highest level, the two presidents met and worked out what the basic contours of the Paris Agreement would be some months before Paris. It was not only these two countries, so you can't make an agreement with just two, but the EU, the European Union, was extremely active. The island countries I've mentioned already. Situation for Canada, I mean, Canada at that point had been mostly under the Harper government, which wasn't really interested in climate change. The Trudeau government was only elected a few weeks before Paris, so it was very early days, but still, with the new government, there was very much a sense of wanting to re-engage with climate negotiations. And we had developments in the G7, for example, where that summer the G7 agreed to the concept of phasing out fossil fuels, which was a huge shift over where we had been some years ago. Alliances also proved to be very important. We had the emergence in Paris of a very interesting group called the High Ambition Coalition of Governments, which was founded by the EU and the island countries, but by the end of the conference, virtually everybody, including the United States, had joined the High Ambition Coalition because everybody wanted an ambitious agreement. And there was no, I guess it's important also to footnote, to say explicitly, no government was arguing against an agreement. Yes, there may have been some who wanted an agreement that was less meaningful or less impactful, but there was no one who was working against an outcome of some sort. And there I include the oil exporting countries. At the end, there were a couple of countries who were unhappy with the result, but not because of what it achieved, but because it was not ambitious enough. So that was, I think, an important footnote. Then I wanted to say, to look at what I call political or negotiating issues. And I have six of these. How these changed between Copenhagen and Paris. First one relates to the Kyoto Protocol. It's a fairly small issue. But between Copenhagen and Paris, the Copenhagen issue was solved in the sense that in Copenhagen, everything was messy. The convention was mixed up with the protocol. There was all this dispute about who should be having commitments and who not. But in Doha, at COP 18, 20, the Doha Amendment to the Kyoto Protocol was adopted, which extended the Kyoto Protocol. It didn't actually have a huge impact, but its significance was in the fact that it actually happened. And then it took the issue off the table, and Paris could focus on this bigger issue of what is the new commitment regime. So it was much, the negotiating environment was simplified. Second one was the question of finance. Now, finance is extremely important. By finance, I mean support for action by developing countries, which was a general obligation in the convention. And here again, there had been quite a bit of progress since Copenhagen on this in this area. A target of $100 billion per year of support to developing countries had been set and was actually on the road to being implemented. So this meant that although developing countries were very satisfied, there still was a certain level of confidence building that had preceded the Paris conference. The fund that had been thought of to deal with this, the Green Climate Fund, was now operating, and new money was flowing. Almost all of the major countries in their aid programs were increasing the funding for climate issues, whether mitigation or adaptation, and the multilateral development banks, who actually have a lot of money and do a lot of infrastructure investment, were ramping up significantly their funding for climate, clean energy type of things. And this was extremely important for the whole, the credibility and the positive ambience going into Paris. Third issue I would mention is science. There was a pretty strong scientific consensus before the Copenhagen conference, but by the time we reached Paris, it was the international scientific community was of one voice. There was no dispute about climate change. There was no credible voices. There were no voices of denial amongst governments or the mainstream. Even business, the business community was firmly on board with the science. So the scientific argument was not on the table at all. Fourth factor that I think is really, really effective, we're getting into the more important ones now, which were, there had been a number of intractable negotiating issues that had made the achievement of a positive outcome in Copenhagen difficult, so actually possible. All of these had, at least a number of these, had advanced in the 6 years between Copenhagen and Paris and were in the end solved in Paris, but because of the groundwork that had been laid. I mentioned two or three of these. The first is, I mentioned already this concept of what are the nature of the commitments and who takes these commitments. Developed countries, developing countries, are they different? What emerged in the lead up to Paris was something called the concept of nationally determined contributions. So unlike Kyoto, which has quantified targets for each country, the commitment in the Paris Agreement is that countries will make a nationally determined contribution, which they will set themselves. For example, for Canada, is that Canada would reduce its emissions by 30% between 2005 and 2030. Each country has a different one, there is not so easy to compare, but everybody was making their own. This was very important for the United States, which meant that the agreement could then be endorsed without having to go through Congress, because it did not mean a fundamentally new commitment. So the US pushed very hard on this concept. It was also in China's interest. China liked the flexibility that was inherent in this. What was interesting also was that these so-called NDCs, nationally determined contributions, had to be submitted before the Paris Conference. We thought we'd get 50, we'd be lucky if we got 50 or 60. Okay, we got 190, which was, to me, a clear demonstration of the momentum that was building before. A lot of work went into this, they didn't just happen. Many countries pushed and paid for these, and it was really quite a remarkable achievement. I mean, now the issue is implementation, and how these are delivered, and then how they are made more ambitious. Then I keep mentioning this question of what in the jargon is differentiation between industrialized countries and developing countries. And this was finally solved in Paris with this concept of NDCs. So all countries have to prepare an NDC without differentiation. The word or the concept of differentiation is woven throughout the Paris Agreement, but never in a commitment context. All of the specific commitments are the same for developed and developing countries. So those who were, hardliners in the historical responsibility camp, think this is terrible that developed countries have been absolved of their historical responsibility, so they say. But it was an essential component of getting an agreement and a new regime that would be one that would fly around the world. And this is why you often hear the Paris Agreement saying it's called one that applies to all countries. All of the agreements apply to all countries, but the commitments are not differentiated. And the US and China were the ones who fixed this problem, basically, and everybody else came in around it. There was important changes in finance, which I mentioned already. You may be interested in the evolution of thinking about adaptation to the impacts of climate change. It was traditionally, adaptation is sort of the poor child of the climate negotiations, didn't get much attention. And for Paris, the developing countries, and in particular the island countries, were insistent that it achieve political parity with mitigation. And I'm not sure we've actually achieved that 100%, but at least on paper, in the Paris Agreement, one has achieved that, so that shift was also important between Copenhagen and Paris. And finally, in going into Copenhagen, we had no idea what the outcome was going to look like. It could have been a protocol, it could have been an agreement, it could have been an amendment to the Kyoto Protocol, it could have been all sorts of different things. In the end, it was nothing, pretty much. In Paris, we knew exactly what it was going to be. It was going to be a new international agreement. And you can't imagine how that simplifies a negotiation when you actually can begin to think about what the outcome. My fifth point, and here I apologize if this sounds arrogant, but the negotiations were impeccably organized. There were, unlike most climate meetings, no procedural controversies. And I put this down to two things. One was the desire of governments to have a positive agreement, so they didn't need to fight about stupid things like, is this on the agenda, is this not, and should we not be meeting at a given time? But the second element was the leadership by the French presidency on the Paris conference was outstanding. Laurent Fabius, who was the president of the conference, when really came to understand why he could be prime minister of France at 33 years of age. He was a fantastic diplomat, extremely smart, very astute, politically sensitive, could also be a real difficult person, but I guess that's part of many great leaders are. But the French mobilized their entire diplomatic network, which is big as a permanent member of the Security Council, to deliver a result. I contrast this with the situation in Copenhagen. The Danes also had a large effort. They were very well intentioned, but they blundered all over the place. For example, they had secret texts, and they changed the president in the middle of the conference, so going from the Minister of Climate to the Prime Minister in the middle of the conference. And that points to one of the big differences was that in Paris, the governments, they trusted the French not to screw them, basically. In Copenhagen, there was no trust. And that is an essential ingredient for a good outcome in international negotiation. The French made huge efforts to make sure that everyone was consulted. I remember going into the conference, I was afraid, okay, here we think of France, permanent member of the Security Council, they're probably only going to talk to the other big powers. No. Everybody was consulted. And by the end of the conference, everyone felt that they had been heard, not just listened to, but heard. We had an interesting comparison in the two conferences in terms of participation by heads of state and government in Copenhagen. The heads of state and government came at the end of the conference for the last two or three days, supposedly to celebrate the victory that should have been there for them to welcome, but in the end getting stuck in negotiations. It was a total nightmare. And in Paris, it was actually President Hollande who decided in the end the heads of state and government would come at the beginning. And this turned out to be an absolutely brilliant tactic, because we had 150 heads of state and government come to Paris on the first day. It was the most the worst day of my life. But the message from these 150 heads of state and government was, we want an ambitious agreement. What are the negotiators going to do after your head of state and government has just told you that this is what we want? So that, I think, was an extremely important contributor to the fact that we did get a good outcome at the end. So I can talk for hours about process, but maybe you have questions about that. Then my last of these list of factors is that the socioeconomic context between Copenhagen and Paris changed significantly. It was only 6 years, but there was very, very major changes over that time frame. First, what happened in the economy? We saw the price of renewables tumble to a huge extent in that short period of time. We saw new actors emerge demanding new investment decisions. Pension funds and risk managers were not prepared to allow the kind of business as usual economics that we had seen. And new business opportunities were emerging, especially in a new economy. And these were, whereas at some point these had been talked about, they were ideas, these are now hard facts, and real money was beginning to move around. Interestingly, the business community, while in Paris there was always a portion of the business community that was interested in, did I say Paris? In Copenhagen, there was always an element of the business community that was interested in climate action. But by the time of Paris, there was a huge lobby in the business community that wanted change, that wanted an ambitious agreement. Their mantra was, we want a clear direction. And the Paris Agreement actually gave them that with its long-term goal. But they were also, these actors were very well organized. So if there was a problem in country X, they could arrange to have Chief Executive Officer Joe Blow or Ms. Smith phone the Prime Minister or the President of that country and say, listen, your guys are fooling around, can you fix this? And this actually happened, and we had business engagement in a positive way. There were also, you know, the negative forces, but they were definitely subject to the other side of the equation. on the economic side, I think it's also important, certainly in an academic institution, to underline that over the course of this time, a number of very serious studies came out, whether from governments or independent studies or from the OECD or the IEA, which basically said not acting costs more than acting, and if you act, you're actually going to make money. And this, again, contributed to this this whole new economic dynamic. In parallel with that, I think we saw an evolution in public attitudes, where there was much stronger desire to seek action. And I've wondered about why this is. Clearly, the non-government community was much better organized in the Paris period than in the Copenhagen period. Groups like 350.org, or Avaaz, or even Green, the more traditional ones like Greenpeace, were very astute in their campaigning and in their organization. You may remember the People's March in New York, which was about a year before the Paris conference. Who would have imagined we'd have 400,000 people in the streets of New York demanding climate action? So these sorts of things then, I think, created space for governments. I would point to a new voice in this constellation over time, which was the faith community. Much more active in mainline churches, but also in many denominations. And of course, we had, just before Copenhagen, a papal encyclical on protection of the earth and climate protection. Again, one of many, many, many contributors to why Paris could be successful. And my own sense is that ordinary people were seeing the impacts of climate change in their life, whether it was severe weather effects that they have where they live or that they read about, seeing the Arctic ice melting. People were getting it that something is happening here and we need to do something about it. And I think we shouldn't underestimate that as a contributor to the success. My last one of these socioeconomic indicators is that in those 6 years, we also saw the emergence of a very effective grouping of cities, regions, provinces, states, so-called subnational actors, who tended to be strongly impacted by climate effects. That's where the flooding happens, that's where people are being really, really affected, but also to have their hands on the levers of how to influence emissions in the form of public transportation, buildings, etc. And these actors became much, much more engaged and demanding and solution-oriented in the time between Copenhagen and Paris, and this had a very big impact. So my conclusion of these six factors that I've mentioned is that coming all together, these change the narrative around the climate change issue from one of it being negative, this is a terrible thing, we're all going to be having our lives ruined, and we can't save ourselves, it's going to cost too much. The narrative changed. Yes, it's not good, but it's possible. We can do it, and we can actually end up better in the end afterwards. So that I think was a important result of the meshing of all of these influences, and that involved. It didn't just happen by accident because there was important strategic. That's why I asked why people were activists. And activists and other entities were able to influence this. By strategic communications, by the timing of events, by ensuring that this contributes to feelings of momentum. And this is a very, I think for other issues, a really important factor that can be used if you want to see change. And the basic conclusion from all of that was that with these changes, governments could be more ambitious. They didn't need to be afraid, they didn't need to equivocate. And I think that was a very important element for why we had an ambitious outcome. So I have a couple of conclusions, and then we can get down to questions. So the first is that the Paris Agreement revealed that multilateralism works. But the conditions have to be right. The governments need to want an outcome. You can look around, and we saw in Copenhagen where multilateralism doesn't work. But that's when governments don't agree, when they're Then the other contributors that I would highlight were the leadership by powerful countries and the development of alliances. This was really, really, really critical. The time and effort invested in finding solutions. You can't imagine how much time is wasted in sterile repetition of this is my position, this is my position. That doesn't get you anywhere when you do that for 10 years. You need to find a way to find an outcome which allows everyone to walk away feeling that they have won something. And people, governments invested in that in the pre-Paris time. Sometimes it seems difficult to see how you would do that, but I think I'm an optimist that we can do that on other issues. The economic changes were critical. The price issues, the business sector issues, and as was public support and wide engagement, and the intergovernmental process was a good model. That led to two things. Governments were enabled to act and to be ambitious. And a final point, I think momentum is extremely important. Over the course of 2 years, the way events are staged, the way announcements are made, the way groups, this has to be done in a coordinated way with groups working together, diverse groups working together to ensure that the end result builds on what comes before. And we had a very good model of that in Paris, and I think it's really important for other issues. One postscript, I've said a lot of terrible things about Copenhagen, and it really was a nightmare. But Paris would not have been possible without what happened in Copenhagen, partly because of this legacy issue that we can't fail again. But in the Copenhagen Accord that I mentioned, three of the essential building blocks of the Paris Agreement had been pre-cooked, basically, which was the objective of not exceeding global temperature change more than 2 degrees, the $100 billion per year support for developing countries, and the Green Climate Fund, and the nugget of this concept of national internal contribution, moving away from quantified, the voluntary submission of top contributions. Those were the key elements of the Copenhagen Accord, and then were legitimized and made into treaty language through the Paris Agreement. And that's why Copenhagen has sometimes been referred to as the most successful failure in history. So on that happy note, I'll then throw open for some questions and comments. I'd really be interested in your reactions and your assessment of what's happening. But one commercial before I do that, I've been working on a project with my former boss, Christiane Figuera. She may remember as the former head of the Climate Change Secretariat. We're launching on Thursday of this week a website which will contain perhaps 75 to 100 personal stories by people who were involved in the Paris negotiations, everyone from Laurent Fabius to Greenpeace to the Pope. This can be found at Profiles of Paris, one word, profilesofparis.com as of 31st May. So if you're interested in digging deeper on what happened in Paris, please have a look. So, that's what I hope was interesting for you and helpful, and now let's take some questions or have some comments, reactions, a bit of discussion. Yeah.
Thank you for the interesting talk. A couple of things I want to hear more about. One you kind of mentioned is the fact that I think one reason why Paris succeeded while Copenhagen failed was the fact that they basically got rid of the notion of historical responsibility, right? And I want you to reflect on, you know, whether that's the right thing to do. I mean, in the sense you may succeed, but in the sense that you're erasing something very important here. And the second question is, sort of implicit in your talk is the idea that Paris is successful, right? Because it came out of the treaty. I didn't hear you even sort of talk about Trump withdrawing from the Paris Accord and so on. If the United States is going to walk away from this, then can you still consider it to be a success?
All right, historical responsibility. The basis of this question is the fact that the industrialized countries have been spewing emissions into the atmosphere since the Industrial Revolution, and basically have created the problem of climate change. raised in the Framework Convention. It was, as I said, the sort of foundation of the bargain in Kyoto that we continue this concept of not so much historical responsibility is very contentious as a term. The industrialized countries hate it. And what that gets translated as leadership by industrialized countries. And that concept is actually in the Paris Agreement. It's woven in several places that this, this, and this may happen on the understanding that industrialized countries are leading. So I think it has definitely declined in prominence, but it hasn't gone away. And I personally feel, I get very frustrated actually with those who argue that the Kyoto Protocol was illegitimate because it only had commitments by industrialized countries. Because it was a fulfillment of this concept of leadership by industrialized countries. And in many ways, the length of time that it has taken to get an agreement is because of the lack of action by many industrialized countries to do either in terms of emissions or financial support what they should have done. So I would say it's not gone. It's reflected in the Paris Agreement in quite nice ways, it's a very, very nicely crafted ways. And the foundation of these national contributions is very much that there's still an expectation that the industrialized countries should be more ambitious than the developed countries. And that one of the most important outcomes of the Paris Agreement was the long-term goal, which is basically that global emissions should peak as soon as possible. So time frame not defined, but as soon as possible. And then by the second half of the 21st century, that emissions and removals by carbon sinks should be in balance, i.e. net zero emissions. So emissions are going to have to go peak quickly and go down fast, with the leadership being there in industrialized countries. I think we also, I'm not a scientific expert or a data expert, but I think we also have to bear in mind that the impact of China in this whole question is huge. Their emissions are so large, and their per capita emissions are approaching some Western countries. And even their historical responsibility contributions are actually getting into the domain where it's becoming a bit more relevant. Because of the scale and now the time frame, it's what, 15 years of very intensive growth in emissions in China. So that makes the issue a bit more blurry. And you see, emissions had peaked for a couple of years, global emissions, and then in the last year of data came out, they peaked, they went up again, and that was because of coal use in China rebounding a little bit. So the success of Paris. Well, as I said at the beginning, getting an agreement is a miracle in many cases, so Paris was definitely a success, and the world really celebrated this outcome. I didn't mention Trump because for me, he's he shall not be named. I can't say that this is not a problem. I mean, obviously, when you have the administration of the most important economy in the world pulling out of the Paris Agreement, it will take them some years to do so. But even more troubling, basically destroying the regulatory basis on which they were going to meet their undertakings under the Paris Agreement, this is very, very troubling. What gives me hope is that in the U.S., I think, and in the world generally, a lot of what's happening is now taking on a momentum of its own. Renewables make sense. No matter what President Trump says, the coal industry is not coming back. The other actors in society, even business, I mean, not some of the more like the coal, the Koch brothers, and these kinds of people. That's not who I'm talking about. But many sectors of society, many business sectors, Unilever is a good example, but there's many others. Even Walmart, for goodness sakes, are very, very progressive in their approach to climate policy and energy in particular. That is going to have a huge impact, I think. The price initiative combination will be very powerful. And again, action of states in the United States, provinces and Canada, can be extremely important in providing the basis. So we have seen, after the announcement by the Trump administration, a coalition of states and cities who have come together to basically say, we're going to deliver on the US commitments without the federal government. Now, we'll have to see if that rhetoric can be turned into reality, but there are promising indications. There will be a very big non-state actor conference in California in September of this year, and I think that will be a critical place to assess, is the momentum continuing?
So you mentioned a few times the role of, let's say, technology, so fracking, the drop in price of renewables is kind of enabling progress, but I guess to what extent do you think the framework convention enabled the technological advances to occur, or you know, is there a feedback? And obviously that's sort of relevant for moving forward as well.
Good question. I wouldn't want to play it up too much. I think in the case of Paris, there's a much stronger case to be made because the signal from the treaty is much stronger. Basically, this long-term goal of peaking and declining to net zero. The previous treaties, I think, were an important part of the economic and social context, but the consensus around them was not strong enough that you could say this was a defining factor. As I said, Kyoto, I think, kept the issue alive, and that was a very important contribution. But many of these things happened in the economy for other reasons, and I do hope we'll see that more and more of this growing from the kernel of the first changes, in particular the renewables. And I think we should also not underestimate the influence that large investment funds are going to have. There's increasing talk about divestment, but also more positively, where do you put your investment money for the future, for a post-carbon society? I mean, we have with the Paris Agreement a very interesting situation where we have set a destination which is a low or no carbon society for the world, with industrialized countries supposedly in the leadership. But we all know it's not going to happen tomorrow. But that means you then have 30, 40, 50 years to make this transition, and here the challenge is to the public policy community, to make this transition in a way that we don't have more workers thrown out and turned into populists. We don't have social and economic disruption, but we do it in a way that in the end society is a better place. That's a real gift, actually, that you can plan this over 50 years. I wish I could be optimistic that it would happen, but anyway. That's the challenge. Public policy, students, governments of tomorrow, that's your challenge. Please.
So my question to you might be a little bit different, but I remember I first heard your name specifically 3 years ago during the 2015 Paris conference, because I come from a public relations communications background, and you know, sometimes my friends call me a masochist because I seek out and I listen to what's termed alt-right. Not because I believe in it, but it's important to listen.
Sorry,
to.
Sorry, what do you seek out?
What's termed
alt-right. Okay.
And basically what I was hearing when they specifically mentioned your name is you put in that shall instead of should on purpose, because what they said was the UN wants to take over America. Like that's an argument that they talk about. Like, it's nonsense, obviously. I guess my question to you is, can you talk about your frustrations or your, how do you feel when you, I'm sure you're aware of this kind of, you know, fake news or nonsense out there. How do you feel about that? How frustrating is it?
I actually didn't know that the alt-right had put me in their crosshair, so that's a very interesting. I mean, what he's referring to is in the final day of the negotiation of the Paris Agreement, we discovered that one of the most important phrases in the treaty included the word shall. Industrialized countries shall do something when it should have been should, which changed it into a binding commitment, which meant that it would have to be endorsed by the U.S. Senate, and we have basically killed the agreement. So when this was a mistake. It happened in the middle of the night. We had just 30 people were reading the text. Everyone was exhausted. Our eyes had read should and shall 500 times, and it just was a mistake. So I was the lucky guy who had to read out that we were going to change shall to should. So it is fake news, a complete fantasy. And what is interesting, actually, is that this would have been a golden opportunity for anybody who wanted to block the agreement to object to that change. No one objected. Partly because it had been deftly handled behind the scenes, but also because they knew we want the United States to be in this agreement, and if we want the United States to be in an agreement, we have to do this. And it was every other previous version of the agreement had ensured that. So it was clearly a mistake. So do I get frustrated by this? I guess so. But generally, any of this fake news, alt-right stuff is more than frustrating. It's really infuriating to see the negative, disrespectful manipulation of information and news to influence public attitudes. We have seen a lot of that in the climate debate over going back 20 years. Perhaps not quite as crass as that. And something I guess one has to, as part of this ongoing struggle against fake news, be vigilant against this type of thing.
You mentioned basically the spelling that went into Paris and also the level of Biden. I'm just curious, when do you know that the negotiations in Copenhagen were going to go sideways? If you could have, there was a moment or, you know, within the negotiation itself, you could, if there was a change you could make looking back retrospectively, what would that be?
That's a really interesting question. I tend to feel myself personally that in this huge epic event, as you walk around, there is a feeling about what's going to happen. And I think from the moment of arrival in Copenhagen, I had the feeling that this was not going to work. That the whole, here I'm showing my 60s upbringing, but so the karma was bad. Paris was completely different. From the first moment, one had a sense this was going to work. And it became a question then of how difficult it was going to be and how much ambition there was going to be in the agreement. But it was from one high to the next in Paris, whereas Copenhagen was a slippery slide from one moment of desperation to an even worse one. I think I said this to
Okay, because I understand that determined contributions are not going to get the temperature rise to under 2 degrees. Mm-hmm. So how does this get rationalized?
Yeah.
If you've got these two separate things in the same agreement,
yes.
They're ecosystem.
Because there's a third thing in the agreement, which is the ambition mechanism, so-called in the vernacular. So it was clear that, and I think this is a very interesting issue for many policy debates. You know, do you go for perfection, or do you go for everything, or do you compromise to get what you can and try to then make improvements later? So the conscious decision in Paris was that we would take what we could at the time, harvest what we could, which was what was in the national determined contributions, which, if you add them up, point to at least a 3 degree temperature increase, whereas the Paris target is below 2 degrees and 1.5 degrees, if possible. So the second element of what was in the Paris Agreement was a process of 5-year cycles of negotiation to have new NDCs in every 5 years, and there's a specific provision in the Paris Agreement that indicates that these national determined contributions should not be less ambitious than the previous one. So no backsliding. That interestingly, was a very, there was a lot of debate about when the US pulled out. You know, why don't they just submit a new NDC that has less ambition in it? And would that have then been contrary to the treaty, which says you have to be more ambitious? So for international legal scholars, that could be an interesting thesis topic for you to work on. So the answer to your question is that this ambition mechanism is the key to moving towards more ambitious targets. And this year is actually quite an important year in that regard, because at the Conference of the Parties that will take place later this year, there is to be agreement on what the process would be for sort of getting to the next round of NDCs, an assessment of where we are in implementing the current NDCs, and what has to happen next. So that would be one to watch, actually. Apparently the discussions around it are actually quite difficult at the moment. Yes?
You've spoken about the growing awareness of the importance of adaptation over several years in various climate policy meetings, and the fact that they're potentially on parity in principle with innovation and the Paris Agreement. And there's some evidence of that, obviously, in the global adaptation and the facts of the agreement. I guess I'm just curious about the degree to which you see motivation or action on those challenges and opportunities versus the challenges and opportunities of mitigation, which are very different in nature. If you could speak to your short thoughts on adaptation.
Good question. I'm not particularly well informed expert on this. I come out of the mitigation side of the school. But I think what is important here is as impacts are increasingly felt, and at local level, principally, there's going to be increasing pressure, not only pressure for action, but a necessity for action. You need to then factor in what the water and rainfall impacts are going to be, or sea level rise. These will increasingly, by virtue of necessity, need to be more prominent. And while that sort of comes naturally, I think, in a policy discussion in an industrialized country or in a well-developed economy, it's much more challenging in developing countries where the resources are so much more constrained. And that is why developing countries were basically prioritizing adaptation, because impacts were strong and they had the least means by which to take these on. We have seen, I think, in development assistance and in multilateral development banks, a bit more focus on adaptation, but frankly, it has been for 20 years actually, how these development banks, bankers basically, decide how to pay for adaptation. Is it infrastructure, or is it, would it have happened anyway, these types of, and how much of it should be paid for by industrialized countries as ODA? Versus what should be paid for by national resources. These sort of questions are still very much in the air. In theory, well, not in theory, by policy decision, half of the resources of the Green Climate Fund should be sort of some in the tens up to $100 billion are supposed to be for adaptation. And that will be something to watch, actually, to see the success of how that is implemented.
So you mentioned DIVES, and I'm part of the UBC 350 group, and
I haven't been. Can you maybe come?
Yeah. You mentioned DIVES and how important DIVES is. I'm part of the UBC 350 group, where we are pushing the board of governors to divest, and we've had 1% of UBC endowment divested from fossil fuels, but we continue to fight against the pressure for the board of governors to think that it's essential for us to be investing in these fossil fuel industries, and it's becoming increasingly more difficult, I think, for me, especially to continue fighting because there's so much resistance to divest. So just wondering, like, in the campus context, like, what words you have for student activists and also faculty to make sure our campus is on the right track to divest?
I would think that, so from my experience, the sort of things that would be helpful would be strong alliances with other universities, with other people in the divestment community, in particular to show success stories where this hasn't been at an economic penalty. It works, basically. So that would be one element. And I think, I don't know to what extent there are such actors, but there are some of the big economic think tanks and institutes are also looking at this and basically concluding that, okay, divestment is not such a kooky idea. It actually is quite prudent. And to really increase this argument about the risk that the funds are being exposed to by being invested in an industry which has no future over the next decades. So to turn it, if you can turn the discussion from a negative, a divestment, to investment in the positive and in the future, and in fact by keeping with business as usual, you're at risk. That may be one way to come at this, and please don't give up.
You mentioned populism briefly in the context of unemployed workers. It seems that populism is running deeper than just unemployment. There's a lot of cultural stuff that's happening worldwide. We see just what's happened in Italy, and of course, you know, Hungary, Poland, Turkey, India. You could even argue China is becoming more and more populist. Do you see populism as a major threat, or do you think it's sort of a temporary phenomenon that's going to fade away?
I believe in democracy. So if the people are unhappy, they should be listened to. So I get a bit irritated about the discussion of populism, which in the mainstream thinking sort of seen as these negative extremists. And I would think what lay behind my comment was that I believe that a lot of this disaffection in society now arises from the fact that we have a liberal economic model which has favored corporate interests. And workers, ordinary people, have suffered at the expense of this this economic model, and they're now mad as hell. One of those manifestations is unemployment. It's also poor wages, it's housing. All of these issues which are important to the daily lives of people are being given short shrift in the context of supporting this agenda of corporate growth, and we see income inequality as a great example of that. So, yes, there are other issues associated with this, but I have a feeling that sort of the basic element of this anger in so many societies is the failure of the liberal economic model. And, well, perhaps not the failure, that's too strong a word, but the negative consequences of this economic model, which has been taken to an extreme, in some countries in particular, by then completely downgrading the social support structure that is needed for social harmony. So that, in that sense, I think that the challenge for public policy is here we have an opportunity. The result of this is the implementation, ad hoc implementation of economic trade agreements, of tax reduction, of all of these various economic policies that have been implemented, probably without a lot of reflection about how A adds on to B or adds on to C. If we step back and say, okay, in 50 years we need to be zero carbon, we should be able to design how we get there in a way that would mean that if you don't take action, unemployed co-workers are not automatically going to get green jobs in solar energy. But if you have a public policy intervention in some way, you can find ways that people can prepare over the course. 30, 40 years in an economy and a society is a hell of a long time. So it is possible with, and here I guess it comes down to a belief that there is a role for public policy, for government institutions to improve society. And that to me is the way to respond to these, whether it's populism or social anger about the way that change has negatively affected.
So what you're saying is that in order for humanity to meet climate change goals, we have to actually redesign the existing global economy.
Well, I think one needs to look at what the drivers are and design policies that can turn things in a different direction. And I don't think we're going to move away from, in a fundamental way, from the current economic model, but social safety nets, for example, they're necessary to deal with what happens when jobs move offshore. What should be the investment strategies of governments for a new economy, for the fact that the job profiles are going to change at the risk of being inflammatory? Is it Kinder Morgan or is it something else? These are the sort of questions that at least need to be thought about in designing the kind of society we want in the future.
Did I see a hand here? No.
one last question, and I think we've actually run out of time.
Okay, well, how are you? How do we persuade our Prime Minister not to build infrastructure that's being necessary in your lifetime to be used in the same financial sense?
I don't know. Especially, I haven't lived in Canada for a long time, so I'm very hesitant to prescribe what might happen here, but from my experience, it's things like be active. Don't sit back and let these decisions be made without making a mistake. Recruit allies. Who are the allies for a different vision of where this is to go? And mobilize those kinds of people. It doesn't. And also, what can be done behind the scenes can be extremely helpful. I mean, this decision is not, yes, the government decision is made, but the construction is a long way away. There's a heck of a lot of things which have to happen between now and the start of construction where certain policy interventions, in particular by economic actors, could be very influential in shaping where this comes at in the end. And going in the streets. All right, well thank you very much. I hope you found it.